please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
CNBC TV18's Lessons in Leadership with Indra Nooyi.
Over the past 14 years at CNBC TV18, I've been trying to understand the principles of leadership. Can effective leadership be defined by an aphorism? What makes a leader good or bad? Please join me in welcoming Indra Nooyi, a leader with courage, heart, and a sense of humor.
If you talk to my husband, he'll say, let me explain your priorities. It's PepsiCo, 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 PepsiCo. Then it's the two daughters, your mother, and then I'm not on the list.
Are you a left-brain leader or are you a right-brain leader?
In the past, CEOs were extremely impersonal. I think in today's world, CEOs and C-suite executives should be highly visible. They should have empathy with the employees.
You're bringing this very nice, interesting, warm touch. I'd like to call it the Indian touch, the womanly touch, sisterly, motherly, whichever works better for you. But I don't think that's happened a lot. Hard-nosed CEOs in America, that's what Wall Street likes, that's what they want. And interestingly, what's happening at India right now is a lot of the old, lovely, warm charm of leadership is probably going away. The kind of stuff that happened with the House of Tatas, the Birlas, even Narayan Murthy at Infosys, a lot of that is changing and people are actually wanting the hard-nosed stuff. I'm just fascinated at the change, and I also love to get your comments on, is this something we can expect more of in the US? Are you seeing more companies do this, or is it just you?
If you talk to the average executive in PepsiCo, they might even refer to me as Dragon Lady, or she's tough, and boy, she really drives a hard bargain. So what I'm talking about is not becoming soft and forgetting that hard-nosed business instincts. That's not what I'm talking about. What I'm saying is ruling a company, running a company with head, hands, and heart. In the past, it was head and hands. All that I'm suggesting is bring the heart into the workplace, because if you don't, you cannot get the loyalty of your employees. And the worst part is you cannot run a company with lots of mediocre talent. What you need is a few stars. You need a few very, very good people who can then pull up the others. And to me, empathy is a very critical part of bonding them to the company. I tell you one thing, every one of my executives who report to me, I know everything about their life, their families, their issues, their trials and their tribulations. If they have a personal issue at home, they do talk to me about it. And we find a way to help them. Now, they love PepsiCo, and when they leave the company, if they ever do, within months they're looking to come back because they know that this company cares about them as much as, you know, we expect them to give to the company. And I think that's going to become the norm because everybody's going to try to hold on to talent, but you've got to bond the talent, not just buy the talent.
Excellent. Sairi.
One of the questions I have personally debated a lot of times is leadership and being vulnerable. So a lot of times we hear women saying, why is it hard for women at top to talk about hardships along the way or vocalize hardships that they have faced? And somewhere down the line, I was having a conversation here with my friend, and she said, maybe it's a leadership thing, it's not a women thing.
I talk about the hardships coming up the ladder because they're real hardships. When I talk to employee groups, I talk about the hardships because they're real hardships. And maybe if I talked about them and I talked about how I overcame them, you know, the worst thing is to just whine about the hardships. It's how did you power your way through those hardships and then get to a better place? Because those are all lessons that you can impart to other people. If you're willing to approach it that way, if women together can form a sisterhood and talk about it, there's no harm. I think we ourselves have got to get more comfortable about getting our numbers together to talk about these issues.
But how much does it have to do, Indra, with this business of trying to fit in? You said that women are trying to be the man. Women are trying to fit into exactly the same stereotype because you want to get a place on the table. You want to be seen as one of them. And that comes back to the question. So you don't vocalize how you feel. You don't talk about how hard the journey has been. You don't talk about how unequal you're really made to feel in the workplace because you don't want to stand out.
That's a great question, Shireen, but you have to figure out how to be better than everybody out there, how to build your own confidence, and not constantly look for acceptance and endorsement from the men. Because if you keep playing that game, you're never on firm ground. Look, if my kids call when I'm in a meeting, I take the call. When my kids call my husband, he never takes the call, right? That's the reality, but that's okay. So that's the point. You've got to be comfortable in your own skin. And once you show that you're good at what you do and you're comfortable in your skin, people just have to accept it. Remember, you've gotten to the C-suite. You're a big shot right now. Other people just have to live with it and suck it up, okay? So
Valerie.
Did you, looking back 35 years, 30 years, 25 years, did you always know where you were going? And how did you, or was it more of a gradual evolution to where you saw yourself, what you wanted to achieve in building up your confidence?
Here's a piece of advice for everybody. If you go to a job and say, I want to be CEO, and start running for office, you spend your time on the politics and running for office, you forget that you have to do a very, very good job on the job that you've been given. I remember I'd sometimes turn in a board presentation to Steve Reinemann or Roger Enrico, who I both worked for, who were my predecessors, and I'd say, this is a board presentation, could you read it? They wouldn't read it. They'd say, just present it, it's fine. My experience is, whatever you're given, zoom out of it and look at it from 25,000 feet, 10,000 feet, and say, why was I given the problem? How does the solution to this fit into a broader framework that the company's trying to address? Should I go reach out to those people to make sure that I'm addressing this problem the right way so that it'll benefit the company? So if you think a little bit more expansively and zoom out before you zoom in, you'll find that people actually appreciate what you do.
I last heard you speak around 10 years ago, and you actually inspired me in a certain direction. But my question is a little based on what you just said, which is when you're the CEO, you get to call the shots and you can actually create a more welcoming environment for yourself. Now, you can be a CEO the route that you have taken, but you could also be a CEO by being an entrepreneur. And my question is, did you ever consider that?
I didn't, because I was down this corporate ladder and, you know, I was chugging along. I have to tell you something. All of you entrepreneurs, I have the ultimate, utmost respect for every one of you, because you created the company. You wrote the book on the company. I stepped into a book that's been written, and I'm adding pages to it, getting rid of some pages. So I stepped into a framework, and I'm making this company better.
Advertising, particularly in companies by PepsiCo, is a very powerful medium. You spend so much on advertising. I wonder if you could consider, for PepsiCo, in India at least, to bring out social messages very cleverly, but they have an impact much larger than all the humdrum ads that government can bring out. Thank you.
Let me tell you, in the United States, a couple of years ago, maybe 3 years ago, we had a Super Bowl advertisement, which was for people who were hearing impaired. And it was a bold experiment, but we put the ad on Super Bowl, which was unheard of because it's an expensive slot and nobody ever does a niche advertisement of that sort. But we decided to do it because we felt that group of people were ignored. So we decided to put the ad. So we as a company who always are at the edge of culture, we're always defining culture, we are not averse to putting out social messages. The only thing we have to be careful about is that as a consumer brand, we don't have a backlash from the social message. So I'll make sure I talk to our PepsiCo people to look at that.
Akhila.
Hi. My name is Akhila, Akhila Shivadas. I'm part of a nonprofit organization called Center for Advocacy and Research. You started your whole presentation about the difficult times we were living in and all the volatility. I'm just wondering, do you factor in all the resistance there is all over the world, you know, to the kind of paradigms of development that companies like you bring into poorer countries? Does that trouble you? Do you engage with that? And if you do, how so?
Remember, all of our employees come from India. You know, all of PepsiCo's employees come from India. And they might be PepsiCo employees when they come to work at PepsiCo, but they're members of the community when they go home. So they want PepsiCo to be a responsible employer in India. And if we want to have a long-term future in India, we have to make sure our business model is inclusive growth. It's not, you know, elitist growth, if you want to call it. So at every point in time, what we're looking to see is how can we expand the base of our business from a commercial aspect, from a community aspect, so we're doing the right thing for India. When we strive for water balance in all of our plants. We understand the problems with water usage in India. So we don't want to be just a net water user. So we work with agriculture. We work with rainwater harvesting. We build check dams in Aurangabad. We do that so that we can make sure that the communities in which we operate, we work on water balance.
Since you are talking about corporate social responsibility, Indra, let me ask you about what you think about the government's move as part of the Companies Bill to now make it mandatory for companies to spend 2% of their profits on corporate social responsibility. How do you see this business of making corporate social responsibility mandatory?
Personal point of view, bad idea. I'll tell you why. Telling companies how to spend their money, to me, is wrong. What we ought to be focused on is, how does the company make the money? Okay, does your business model make sure that you're environmentally, you're doing the right things environmentally? Does your business model make sure you're treating people the right way? If the business model driving the profits is not a responsible business model, yeah, mandating how a company should spend the money is like asking you to do a project for the government, which could be highly inefficient and not get to the solutions of the country.
Right.
Two very different
I agree with you. Yes. Questions.
The strategy for the organization, is it bottom-up in terms of your teams coming up, or are you seeing throughout the organization certain ideas that you are taking forward, or more of it is more intuitive, which comes from you and you're carrying your management team with your ideas? So that's one question. And the second question is a completely different question, that what is your advice to your daughters who may be very ambitious? I'm a mother of a daughter and just would like to hear your views on that.
Advice for my daughters. All that I tell my daughters is, do whatever makes you happy.
Is that what your mother told you?
Not really, because you see, the difference is that I grew up in a middle class Madras in the 60s and the 70s, or 50s and 60s, where the emphasis was on grades, rank, you better come, you know, first, second, or third, or you better not come home, you know, your grades better be good. It was a whole different strive, strive, strive for the next thing culture. I tried that in my kids. It backfired, right? I always talk about how a dinner table will sit around, and my mother, my dad would eat fast and leave. My mother would sit down with the two daughters, my sister and I, and she'd say, I'm going to eat now. I want you to think about a speech you're going to give me at the end of dinner. If you were president of India, what would you do? Okay, and we both had to give the speech, and then she'd decide who to vote for. So as my kids grew up, my first daughter, my husband and I tried it with our first daughter. We said, she looked at me and she said, Mom, get a life. I've got to watch TV. You see, it doesn't work because the environment is completely different. So my mother never said to me, dream, dream big. She said, on the one hand, you can dream as much as you want because I've told you you can be president or prime minister. On the other hand, she kept saying, I'm going to get you married off when you're 18. So it was a complete contrast. With my kids, I tell them, dream as much as you want. If you want to work for an NGO and do good for the world, don't worry about money. We'll take care of it. But if you work for a corporation, you're on your own, kid. You've got to pay your own bills. So that's what we tell our kids. Let me get to the other question you asked about the strategy for the organization. You know, PepsiCo is a big company, and you can never delegate strategy. Broad strategic direction has to come from the top. But I don't pull out the strategy from thin air. It comes because I've observed, I've talked to our people, I've gotten their input, I've looked at the world around me, around the company. It's through enormous study that you come up with a strategic direction for the company. And then you've got to rally the troops so that they buy into your direction, which is an enormous task. And if they are detractors, you've got to work with them to get them on your page. But after a while, if they still remain detractors, you've got to get them out of the company, because then they start poisoning the company. So you've got to play this buy-in process very, very carefully.
Indian leaders and doing well on the global stage, running global corporations. How much does this have to do with this tiger mom style of parenting? And maybe there is something to it, you know, because this business of grades, 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 you have to work hard, you have to achieve this, it's all goal-oriented. There's also a scarcity of, you know, the options available to you. How much of that is linked to your success, you think?
Could be. You know, a lot of it could be linked to success. Now that I look back, I grew up and there was no TV. So I went to the library all the time, read. Okay. There was no internet. So there was no 15 video games, 3 apps, Facebook, nothing. If you wanted to talk to somebody, you took a bus and went to see them. There was not even a telephone sometimes which worked. You know, you played outside, so you were very healthy. You came back from school and you played. So I think many of us at my age are products of an environment which at that time sounded like, oh my God, we have nothing. But in retrospect, was a wonderful environment which prepared us for the world of today.
What did the leadership lesson by talking about amplitude of change and frequency of change? So my question is more around disruptive leadership that you spoke about. How do you communicate and achieve consistency across the ranks of a large organization like PepsiCo, and particularly you need to rapidly keep changing, you know, driving change across the organization?
In the volatile world that we have, priorities do change. You know, it's interesting. At the top, priorities change more often. As you go down the organization, you have to anchor some priorities, because if everything changes for large portions of people, they cannot handle the volatility. And the top 3 levels of the company are critical. Those levels, you've got to teach them to insulate the rest of the organization from wild swings, but work with the CEO on the volatility. In volatile times, it's more important you're out there, you're visible, you show that you're in charge, and that you're confident. The third, video and you know, the internet is a great vehicle to get messages out to the organization. So even if you can't travel to countries, get those messages out as much as you can, because the organization needs reassurance all the time. And the last thing, values are more important in volatile times. People have to know that you won't ever compromise your ethics, code of conduct, because of volatility. And make sure people understand that's the true north of the company.
Final questions, I have 5 minutes left. Yeah. Yes, go ahead.
Hi, Indra. When you were rising up the ladder, did you encounter any gentlemen who felt uncomfortable with those aspects, you know, the womanly aspects of your style of functioning, your personality, and how exactly did you deal with it?
I'll give you a little story. I used to work for the Boston Consulting Group, and I was based in Chicago. My clients were all in the Midwest. I had a client up in La Crosse, Wisconsin. And I was the only woman on the team. I was the only foreign-born woman on the team. And, you know, I stuck out like a sore thumb in the town, in the company. I stuck out like a sore thumb. There were times when I felt uncomfortable. But I have to tell you, the first three, and the assignment went on for about 9 months. The first 3 months, I was uncomfortable. About the fourth month, I was pregnant with my first daughter, all right? And I'm a vegetarian. I needed very specific meals. This company that I thought was uncomfortable with me, they all got together. They all agreed on a schedule of vegetarian meals they were going to prepare for me. And they put up a schedule with the names of all the people, executives, wives, secretaries, everybody. They all got together in La Crosse, Wisconsin, in this company, and made sure I had a different snack every 2 hours for every day that I was in La Crosse, Wisconsin. Because at no point did I try to hide my pregnancy. No point did I say, I'm not sick. No point did I say, you know, I want to hide my womanness. I said, guys, I'm working for you. I'm going to work my tail off. I'm sick as a dog, and I need a vegetarian meal. Simple. 4 simple things. And guess what? They were phenomenal. Even today, they're friends of mine. So if you focus on the job, and you focus on doing a damn good job with the assignment you're given, that gives you your tailwinds. And you don't have to worry about making allowances for the fact that you're a woman in a predominantly male world.
Indra, I know we're completely out of time, so my final question to you before we let you go. Has the emphasis on the priorities changed when you started Performance with a Purpose? And what is the next goal now that you hope to achieve as the CEO of PepsiCo? I know cost savings and all of that is on track, but what's the larger strategic goal that you would like to achieve in the rest of your tenure?
The most important thing for philosophies like Performance with Purpose is that you don't change the direction before you've accomplished all those goals. They're ambitious goals, lofty goals, but the right goals. And we've gone through hell as a global economy. In spite of that, we're going to stay the course and deliver on those goals. And if PepsiCo delivers on those goals, and we've delivered on many of them, but as we deliver on all of them, I think people are going to look back and say, you know, what were the great companies of the last two decades? I think PepsiCo is going to be amongst them because of performance and purpose, because of who we are, because we set the standard for how a company should make money, not how a company should spend the money. But we did it all while delivering a good financial return for our shareholders. So people are going to look back and say, you know what? PepsiCo is among the defining corporations of the past two decades. And if they say that, I'd say I've left behind a phenomenal legacy for the next CEO of PepsiCo.
Well, you've been a defining leader. Indra Nooyi, it's been a pleasure speaking with you. Thank you very much for joining us here on the show.